Thank you for the introduction. And I'm delighted to be here with you for the 2021 Thrive Live Laugh, Lunch, and Learn event. So today we're going to be talking about ergonomic positioning, some of the key strategies that you probably didn't learn in dental school, but can make the difference between a long and healthy career or early retirement. So, safe posture, what is it? Most of you have heard that proper posture is ear over shoulder over hip, but in the dental operatory, this is pretty useless information, isn't it? But what is much more valuable to know is what does research tell us are the safe limits? So here is what research shows are the safe guidelines or the safe limits. We know that flexing the neck forward greater than 20 degrees is significantly associated with neck pain, which is why we must be so diligent with selecting truly ergonomic dental loops, because most of them on the market don't keep us in that range. Opening the hip angle up over greater than 90 degrees, reaching the forearms forward no more than 25 degrees, and arms angled up only 0 to 10 degrees. So the million-dollar question is, how do we stay in this safe postural working range in the operatory? So when we talk about ergonomics in the operatory, we have a multitude of topics to cover. Today, we're just going to be covering two of these, patient positioning and headrest adjustment. So I teach a 10-step patient positioning sequence, and today we're going to talk about the two steps that have the greatest impact on your posture and comfort in the operatory. So most of you were taught in dental school how to properly recline the patient for upper and lower arches. For the lower arch, we want the semi-supine position no more than 20 degrees elevated from the true supine, which is really a lot lower than some of you may have been taught. The maxillary arch, true supine position. Step three is the one step that tends to cause the most contorted postures in the operatory, yet it's the step that I see most frequently missed when I am doing in-office and virtual consultations, and that is controlling the occlusal plane. The takeaway I want you to get from this section is that the orientation of the patient's occlusal plane directly dictates your posture. And what I mean by this is that the further the occlusal plane, and we're talking about the upper arch here, okay, this is the upper arch, the further it gets forward in front of the vertical, the more this pulls the dentist or hygienist forward into a rounded posture. So we need to get that occlusal plane behind the vertical. The more we can get this behind the vertical, the more directly this impacts your posture. Now we're going to talk about two different headrests here. We'll talk about a double articulating headrest and a flat headrest. For both of these, we're still talking about the upper arch because this is where I see the most challenging postures in the operatory. So when you're positioning the patient in a double articulating headrest, we want to angle that headrest steeply downward. The reason this is so important is to get the occlusal plane behind the vertical. Now, it's important that the patient is positioned properly here or they're not going to be comfortable. So the magic words here are you ask the patient to scoot up until you're comfortable. So when they do this, they're going to position the edge of the headrest right on the occiput, which is where it needs to be for the patient to be comfortable. If you try to do this, half of the time you're going to miss, and then the patient is going to be uncomfortable, which is going to make them resistant to being reclined and positioned properly, right? The way that I want you to check for proper positioning for the upper arch is to perform this mirror handle test that I teach at the dental school. So you flip your mirror around, place the handle on the occlusal plane, and you visualize this from the side and keep extending the headrest until the occlusal plane is about 20 to 25 degrees behind the vertical. Now for hygienists, this is only going to be about 10 degrees behind the vertical. So this is so powerful and directly impacts your posture. Every year I ask my DS2 students to do this little practicum. We start off with the occlusal of number 3, and I ask them to visualize the occlusal of number 3, and every year 75 heads go like this, right? And that's with a mirror. All right, so then I ask them to extend the double articulating headrest down and position Dexter's head back. And now visualize the occlusal of number 3. Every year, 75 heads go from this to almost perfectly upright. This is how dramatically control of the occlusal plane impacts your posture. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, my patient would never tolerate this, right? Hang tight. We know that when we improve the patient's comfort, it improves their tolerance to being reclined, which directly impacts your posture and improves your posture. So, some of these headrests are not super comfortable, and they can be kind of sharp when you angle them down. Another problem here is we have that there is a space right on the cervical curve here that isn't supported in any dental chair, okay? So when that cervical curve where this arrow is pointed, when this is not supported, we know as physical therapists that those cervical muscles go into a state of contracture. And when those muscles go into a state of contracture, the patient becomes very tense and less likely to tolerate being reclined. So what we can do here is insert a dental cervical cushion. In this case, this is a crescent dental cushion. This is important that this is a dental cushion because if this is too large, it's going to be counterproductive and push the patient's head forward and down, right? So these come in two sizes. There is a large size, which was the original crescent cushion, and this is used for flat headrests. The small headrest is for double articulating headrests. The positioning with a flat headrest is very different. So now you're going to ask the patient to scoot to the very end of the headrest. What happens if they don't scoot to the very end of the headrest? Then you have this extra headrest sticking out, right? That you have to either lean your body forward over or you have to reach over. Neither is a good option. So get that head flush with the end of the headrest. Now, the patient probably isn't going to be comfortable, right? Because their lumbar curve isn't going to align with the contours of the chair. So now you can use these other cushions. Crescent also makes a lumbar cushion and a knee roll, and patients absolutely love these. This is a small investment for a big return in your health and your posture. So give it a try. If you do nothing else, just invest in the headrest. Then you need to get in the chair, doctor or hygienist, and role play and feel what this feels like to your patients. Now, too large of a cushion, as I mentioned earlier, is going to push the head forward and the chin down and get the occlusal plane in front of the vertical, which is going to be not helpful for your posture. So a lot of these headrests that come with the patient chairs, I have found to not be small enough to do the job, to get for the for positioning for the upper arch. So I definitely recommend getting one of these smaller headrests. So you can do the same mirror handle test on the occlusal plane of the lower arch now, and we want it to be about 30 to 40 degrees above the horizontal. So hygienists, when you position your patients, you don't really have time to position the patient for the lower arch and then reposition them for the upper arch, right? That just doesn't make sense. So one thing that you can do is just position the chair with the backrest about 10 degrees elevated. And for a flat headrest, you're gonna have to position, adjust the backrest slightly up and down. That's the only way, unfortunately, with a flat headrest that you're gonna be able to control the occlusal plane. So, however, with the proper cushion, they're going to be a little bit more tolerant to that. With the double articulating headrest, you have much more control of the occlusal plane, and you can actually just use the double articulating headrest position between upper and lower arches. So for the upper arch, you're going to angle that double articulating headrest down. For the lower arch, you're going to bring it forward. One of the biggest questions I get is, what's the right clock position? And the answer is, it depends, right? One of the most damaging positions that I see is working in the 10 o'clock position constantly. So working in the 10 o'clock position, you have absolutely no hope of an ergonomic position because you're either reaching over a chest or you're reaching over a patient's forehead. So think about a goal of 70% of your treatment coming from the 11 to 12 o'clock position. Now you're thinking, wow, that sounds like a lot, right? Or I could never do that. Yes, you can. And you'll be surprised when you truly gain control of the occlusal plane and get that behind the vertical when you're treating the upper arch, you'll be amazed how much of your treatment can come from the 11 to 12 o'clock position, which is the most ergonomic position because your arms can be relaxed at your sides and you're not reaching and elevating the arms and shoulders. So maybe you're thinking, but I can't get into the 12 o'clock position. You've got to have this. So the industry standard for clearance in the 12 o'clock position is about 20 to 22 inches. In this particular operatory in Colorado, it was only 14 inches, and all the team members were forced to work in the 10 o'clock position all day long, which is very difficult and very hard on the body. So what did we do? We pushed the patient chair down toward the electrical outlet, but in most cases, you can't get very far here, right? Because a lot of times the box or the plug is so close to the patient chair that you can't gain much here. So in this case, we only got 2 inches. So what else did we do? Then we rotated the patient chairs counterclockwise about 20, 30 degrees. Now, between both of those modifications, which didn't cost us a dime, all the team members were able to work in the 12 o'clock position very easily, and their postures dramatically improved. Patient chairs should allow easy access to the oral cavity. So I have 5 ergonomic criteria that I look at in assessing a patient chair for easy access to the oral cavity. The first one of these is a narrow upper backrest. Sometimes you are going to have to go into the 9 or 10 o'clock position, right? For the right lower posterior quadrant, you might even have to side sit in the 9 o'clock position. That's really difficult with a wide back chair. The assistant is also impacted with a wide back chair. So we need a narrow upper backrest so both assistant and operator can get close when they have to work in those challenging positions. A small, thin headrest, very important, so we can get close proximity in the 11 to 12 o'clock positions. A small footprint or base is important so that your stool, your dental stool, isn't hitting it and keeping you from gaining close access to the oral cavity. A swivel feature is a must-have for the patient chair. And fortunately, most all patient chairs have this nowadays. At least 30 degrees in each direction, it must be able to swivel. And finally, it has to adjust high enough for you when you're standing. So think about this. Maybe do a practicum. Go into your operatory, adjust your patient chair as high as it will go, put the patient supine, and see, can you operate in this position with still having good posture? So it needs to go high enough. Wheelchair patients are some of the most challenging patients that you have, right? So if you have a double articulating headrest, you are well prepared to treat wheelchair patients and have some control over the occlusal plane. You can rotate that patient chair either clockwise or counterclockwise, depending on where the entrance is to the operatory. Then you back the wheelchair up to the patient chair and extend that double articulating headrest and adjust it so that you have a little bit of control over the occlusal plane and the patient will be more comfortable. I've seen some of the worst postures when treating pedo patients, and part of the problem is they don't have control of the occlusal plane, right? Some of the manufacturers say, just take the headrest off and you can treat the patient. Do you have any control over the occlusal plane if you take the headrest off? So that's a really bad idea, because pedo patients are hard enough to treat without having zero control over the occlusal plane. So we need to get these kids' heads up into the headrest. And we can do this with a pedo booster. Again, Crescent makes these pedo boosters. They have two different sizes for really little ones and larger kids. So very important for preserving your best working posture. Geriatric patients can also be one of the populations that is most resistant to being reclined, right? So what we can do to help them is to support that kyphotic posture when they're in the dental chair. And there is a cushion, a geriatric osteopillow that is available that can support them in that kyphotic posture. And then you can imagine then if that kyphosis is supported, then as you recline them, they're going to be much more comfortable and less likely to object. So I have about 12 hours of education to share with you, and we only had a short time here today, so I'd like to offer you some bonus information to kind of supplement what we talked about here today. So if you would like, you can text the number 55444 and enter the word wellness into your cell phone. You can also go to the URL posturedonics.com/bonus, and you'll get my free ebook, 5 Steps to Practicing Dentistry Pain-Free. You'll also receive a video that I prepared that shows a special technique for improving your head posture in the operatory by up to 15 degrees, no matter what type of loops you wear, or even if you don't wear loops. You'll also get a white paper, 14 exercises that research shows dental professionals should avoid. This might surprise you. And finally, my ergonomic checklist, so you can go into your operatory and kind of do your self-evaluation. So what we talked about here today is just the tip of the iceberg. I've got so much more education to share with you. You need to know the criteria for selecting truly ergonomic loops, dental stools, delivery systems, how to properly position lighting. You need to understand the 7 key trigger points that dental professionals are prone to developing and how to self-treat those painful trigger points. Stress management, we know that that can manifest, especially as trapezius pain up here in the neck. We need to be doing chairside stretching, so I offer 20 chairside stretches to teach you. So many of the generic exercise programs and gym equipment that are designed for the general public simply don't work for the dental professional. In fact, they can make your pain worse. So I've developed a very specific exercise program for dental professionals based on the unique pattern of muscle imbalances. So if you'd like to complete your ergonomic and wellness education, there's many more resources available to you at posturedonics.com. Thank you for joining me here today at Thrive Live. Practice in good health.